From the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C.
So delighted to see such a wonderful crowd. I'm John Cole. I'm the director of the Center for the Book in the Library of Congress, and it's our privilege to be one of the several sponsors of this wonderful awards event, which we're experiencing here in the beautiful Hispanic Reading Room, which gives the setting and the character of the event a special meaning for us. The Center for the Book and the Hispanic Division are two parts of the Library of Congress that have come together to sponsor this for the past several years. And it's an important event for the Library of Congress, just as, I'm just going to give you a quick reminder, as is the National Book Festival, which we had a couple of weekends ago in the Washington Convention Center, where we honor writers, including many writers of books for young people and children, and they have a chance to meet their fans, and it's the Library of Congress's biggest and most important public celebration of reading. And events such as the Américas Awards are part of it in many ways. Also, this is a special collaboration with not only, just to make sure I have the name of the consortium right, the Consortium of Latin American Studies Programs, CLASP, which helped originate this, but we have special help from CLASP members and people from Vanderbilt and from Tulane universities, and a special welcome to the young people who are here to take part in this wonderful ceremony. We're very glad to have you. Now, don't get hit your heads on those tables, those of you who are on the floor. I am going to turn the program over to Georgette Dorn, who is going to get us started, and we will hope that you will be able to stay for a while. We also have been asked to remind you that you have a survey form that we hope that you will leave with us. We're making a much stronger effort to get more people here and to keep track of how people learn about this event so we can take advantage of it. So when you go out, if you would take a look, leave your form. And also, I have two other handouts for those of you who didn't come to the book festival. We do have some samples of this book festival program, and just in time for the book festival, a special publication that's especially relevant for what we're doing here. It's called The Joy of Reading. It's a collection of articles about reading and what the Library of Congress does to promote reading. And it's a new issue of the Library of Congress's magazine. So those are things for you to pick up on your way out when the event is over. But in the meantime, please join me in welcoming Georgette Dorn, who's chief of many things at the Library of Congress, but one of the people who has been fundamentally important in this event. Let's give Georgette a hand.
Thank you, John. Thank you, John. Welcome to this wonderful reading room. And it's wonderful to see so many people here, especially young people. We don't get so many young people here every day, but we wish we could. Actually, with our relationship with Tulane goes back to 1992, when I met the CLASP person of the time, and we thought up that it would be very nice to have the event at the Library of Congress. And then from Tulane, it went to Wisconsin, and now it came full circle back to Tulane and Vanderbilt. So welcome, Denise, and welcome, Jamie Lee. And this is a wonderful event that we have done now since 1992 in the Library of Congress. And we're very, very pleased to welcome all of you to celebrate these wonderful books. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Denise Woltering Vargas, and I am the program manager at Tulane University.
And I'm Jamie Lee Marks. I'm the outreach coordinator at Vanderbilt University Center for Latin American Studies.
And we both co-coordinate the Américas Award. We're very pleased to be here this year, especially in the Hispanic Reading Room. So thank you, Georgette Dorn, John Cole, Catalina, and Angela for helping with logistics.
Yeah, so we thought we'd start by giving a brief history of the award. The award was founded in 1993 by Julie Klein at the University of Wisconsin-Milwaukee as a part of CLASP, the Consortium of Latin American Studies Program. The The award encourages and celebrates authors, illustrators, and publishers who produce quality children's and young adult books in the United States that portray Latin America, the Caribbean, or Latinos, and to provide educators with recommendations for classroom use. CLASP offers up to 2 annual book awards, together with a list of commended titles. Submissions are evaluated on the basis of distinctive literary quality, cultural contextualization, the integration of text, illustration, and design elements, and the potential for classroom use. We received 72 submissions this year, which was really exciting, and are proud to announce today 2 winning titles, along with 2 honorable mentions and 13 commended titles. More information about and summaries of those commended titles is available on the Americas Award website, along with some lesson plan ideas and a bunch of other fun resources. And summaries are also available in this handy program that you were handed while you walked in. We hope that you will explore our digital resources and keep in touch with the Americas Award for years to come.
We would also like to thank, of course, our sponsors, CLASP sponsors, CLASP institutions, Florida International University, Stanford University, University of Florida, University of New Mexico, University of Utah, and the University of Wisconsin-Milwaukee, along with Tulane and Vanderbilt. These institutions also have the privilege of being funded through a U.S. Department of Education Title VI National Resource Center grant. We are all National Resource Centers on Latin America. And we'd like to thank our program officer, Carolyn, for coming this year. We're very excited to be offering these types of programs to you through this grant. Thank you, Laura, for bringing Oyster Adams Bilingual School, and thank you, Linda, for bringing your school here as well. We have a special program today, so.
Yes, so now we're going to turn it over to 2 of our America's Award Review Committee members, Maria Sheldon of Ortiz Middle School in Santa Fe, New Mexico, and Laura Kleinman of Oyster Adams Bilingual School right here in Washington, D.C., who will introduce this year's honorable mention titles.
Good afternoon. My name is Maria Sheldon, and it's an honor to be here at the Library of Congress. I am definitely an organized person, but this time around I felt like sharing something very personal. A few weeks ago, my grandmother, Maria Lasso, at 104 and a half years old, passed away. A longtime educator and a believer of the human spirit, it was hard to let her go. It was a very sad moment, yet a celebration for her long life in this planet. I bring her to this conversation because there is something that she taught me that I would like to share with you. I would like for you to close your eyes and let me give you a blessing that my grandmother, Maria Lasso, would say. If it's not registered in our history books, you will find evidence down the road. I give you my blessings. I forgive you and everyone of everything that happened. I give you hope for the past that will enable you to find the richness of any historical event, to accept it and to make it strong and make us stronger for the richness of the legacy that our people have granted us with their own stories. Feel it, learn from it, and learn to feel what others felt. Begin the process of empathy, that is the ability not to only to detect what others feel, but also the experience and emotion yourself. In any historical period, some things were erased, but if you have a chance to learn about that history, embrace it and learn to experience the emotions that all those people experience. I give you my blessings in this journey. In the book Strike, the award-winning author Larry Dane Bremer dramatically captures the story of a partially untold story in our history books. The untold story of Cesar Chavez and his legacy in defending civil rights. The working conditions for many migrant farm workers in this country, the invisible people that provide us with food every night, have been poor, and many workers did not have access to sufficient amount of food or sanitary facilities. It was Cesar Chavez who, as a common man, decided to fight to improve significantly the lives of so many working communities. He brought us together, provided us with new ideas, and asked us to pronounce the key word, huelga, strike. The strike was ultimately successful because people felt and expressed their empathy for farm workers by not buying grapes. Finally, the empathy expressed by action cut the growers' profits to such an extent that they were forced to give in to Chavez's demands. Action took place through empathy. Mr. Bremer, a master researcher unveils the riveting account of the strike and its aftermath with the words of migrant workers, union organizers, grape growers, as well as real images that captured the strike in 1965 and the ones that subsequently followed. More than 100,000 people were organized in 1969, making a difference in the lives of so many communities. And the question continues, what do we do with this revealing history? My grandmother, Maria Lasso, would say, feel it in your blood, feel it in your heart, and make a difference. May this story fill us all with a strong hope as defenders of human rights in this country, in this continent, in this planet, as well as all the humans in Mother Earth. Cesar Chavez told us that it could be done and did it. Therefore, join us in that special chant. Que viva la causa!
Que viva!
Si se puede!
Si se puede!
So now please, it's an honor to introduce my colleague, Laura Kleiman, please, from the Adam Neely Bilingual School. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. Buenas tardes. It's wonderful to see so many people here, and particularly wonderful to see these children who are actually the readers of the books that we give these awards to. I have the honor of presenting one of our honorable mentions. It is called Migrant, and it actually comes with a ribbon that you untie, so it's almost like a gift. It is a very unusual book for in it. Can you hear me? It's, nope. Okay,
I'm,
got it. Okay, it's a very unusual book for a number of reasons, not the least of which is that it was published first in Mexico in Spanish by a press called Tecolote. It was called Migrar, and then Abrams, a wonderful publisher, decided that they were going to take it and publish it here in the United States in 2014 and make it a bilingual book. But I'm not even sure we could call it a book in the traditional sense. It's actually modeled after a pre-Columbian codex. And I'm not tall enough to show you the whole book, but the whole book represents a journey. The book was written by, and I left my notes over there, so I'm going to have to read, José Manuel Mateo. And it was illustrated by Javier Martinez Pedro, who used the techniques from his village of painting on papel amate, which is actually paper made from the bark of trees. And he also, of course, used the structure of the pre-Columbian Mayan, Aztec, and many other people's codexes. And the journey begins here, and I think we're all familiar with this journey. This is the journey of poor families leaving their homes, in this case in Mexico, and traveling under great peril from the south of Mexico through Mexico, getting on board dangerous trains, which is actually depicted here, the train that they call La Bestia. And finally, if they're lucky, making it across the border. This story focuses on a mother and her two children, whose father, the father has already left, and they're going to Los Angeles, or trying to find the father. And it's almost a little bit like Where's Waldo? Because you see the boy in each one of the pictures. But it's not that easy to pick him out. And you see him as he moves slowly northward. You see him as he hides in a hole with his sister, with his mother covering the hole with her body so that they will not be injured by some violent people that they meet along the way. And you see them crossing the border secretly. And here we end up in Los Angeles with skyscrapers and airplanes. I'm just going to read this one small piece. It's actually written in the voice of the boy. And it basically talks in very simple language about how he feels as he is moving from south to north. And he says here, "A lot of people live in the house where we are now. Some are from other countries, but they must be from villages like ours because we all look alike. The good thing about having come here is that there are people who will give us work. My mom, my sister, and I are all going to clean houses. Well, I can't write anymore because they are going to turn off the light. It is time to sleep." And this brings up the very sad reality that some of our children who come here cannot go to school. They have to work to help their families survive. And the author and illustrator, actually dedicate this book to the children who are either lost, disappeared, or die during this journey. And they say, "When children migrate, they cannot themselves legally prove their name, nor can they request documents to do so. Many times they cannot even manage to find out what their real age is. For this reason, we have created this book to demand these children's right to exist." And actually, this is a very good segue because I have been working with my students, third graders, to create, I'm not going to say a scene from the wonderful America's Award-winning book, Separate is Never Equal, Sylvia Mendez and Her Family's Fight for Desegregation by Duncan Tonatiuh. There are kind of pieces from each part of the book, hopefully celebrating the fact that this girl, Sylvia Mendez, was given the right not only to exist, but to flourish by being able to go to the school that was the best school for all of the children in her case, California, not just the white children. So I'm going to call my students to stand up, please. Okay. And we have, why don't you raise your hand when I say your names? Adam Stomberg. Okay. Vivian Shaw. Mm-hmm. Jojo Stacio. Cole Hoffman, Mateo Martinez, and Simone Meisner, and they will tell you that they missed 3 weeks of recess to rehearse this. So we dedicate this to Sylvia Mendez, who we haven't met, and also to Duncan Tonatiuh, who we have met, and the children are very excited to have met him. And I am going to go over and help with one little prop. So I give you the Oyster Adams players. The Oyster Adams actors. Ready, Adam?
Okay.
Thank you.
So I hope that you felt, Duncan, that was a good representation. Thank you. I was very proud of these children because as simple as it looked, it wasn't simple for them. It was very challenging. And they did a wonderful job. And as I said, missed a lot of recess. I would like to introduce someone that I wish I knew better, but I feel like we're sisters in spirit. This is my co-teacher librarian, Linda Mitchell. And I'm ashamed to say I don't even know the name of her school, but I'm going to find out right now. It is called the Stonewall Middle School. And Linda and I decided through some very interesting email exchanges that I would work with my children on Duncan's book, and she would work with her children on our second America's Award winner for young people called Silver People, Voices from the Panama Canal. And you can see that there's many eager faces here ready to share with you what they have prepared. So I give to you my colleague, Linda.
Thank you. Thank you, Laura. Thank you, Laura. I so appreciate being here. I am one of the most fortunate women in the world to be a school librarian at Stonewall Middle School in Manassas, Virginia. I'm fortunate because we have students from all over the world in our school. As you know, we have a high number of Central Americans in this part of our country, and we are celebrating Hispanic Heritage Month right now, and we are absolutely delighted to be here celebrating the America's Award during that time. So I have several students to call up. I'm going to arrange them in a very small space, so please bear with us as I do that. I would like those students with parts to come forward. And one of the things I was able to say to the authors, and I really mean this from my heart, is I want them to keep doing what they're doing. As a librarian, I'm so fortunate to see how literature touches people, our young people. And I think sometimes we adults think that literature has gone by the wayside, and I'm here to tell you, it has not. These are witnesses to that. These are people who have been touched deeply by literature. So, with that, I give you a Reader's Theater adaptation of Silver People by Margarita Engle. Narrator 1.
Today we bring you a construction story and a destruction story. This story of the Panama Canal by Mateo, who helped build it, Anita, who watched the serpent cut grow deeper across to her homeland, the howler monkeys that made way for it, and the trees that accepted the canal as permanent challenges and change. Stonewall Middle School Library presents Silver People by Margarita Engle.
Mateo, from the island of Cuba, job hunt. You can read it right there. Read it right there.
Here is the first thing that someone really does. Where I live for any work at all, any escape from carrying part of my body.
Mateo, number 2. Mateo, La Verbera.
Anita, from the land of many butterflies. Voices. The howler monkeys peering down from trees. One, two, three. Mateo, Pede. The howler monkeys, dynamite. The trees shrinking. One, two, three. Anita, danger. The trees shattered. One, two, three.
When a stream shovel rolls over our roots, we die, but only the wind and rain seem to hear. As we slow our growth of twigs and leaves, while we struggle to repair our roots.
The mosquitoes thirst. Mateo, the hospital. Anita, vulnerable. The trees, home. One, two, three.
Everything lives on the continent. Everything needs wood, leaves, flowers, fruits, seeds. Even the rain needs our roots. And deep mud lifted, released from our green. Water transformed into mist, clouds, more green, new growth, home. No matter how small home has become, just
the
mountaintop island, our home, steady growth.
Narrator 2.
Silver People is a work of historical fiction set in factual situations in real places, where the Panama Canal was built. The mountain that became an island after the canal was built is Barro, Colorado, maintained by the Smithsonian Tropical Research Institute as one of the world's most thoroughly studied remnants of rainforest.
Of the estimated 250,000 Caribbean islanders who worked in Panama between 1850 and 1914, at least one-third never returned to their homelands, but fanned out across Central America.
Strange as it seems, the globalization of international trade did not begin with the internet, but was launched a century ago, when a new waterway called the Panama Canal suddenly made the world seem small.
Thank you. I want to say in closing that this book is rich in voices, and there are many, many, many more voices in this story. We only brought you a few because we were limited in time, but this is just a taste of what you can find in Silver People, and we're just so pleased that it won the award. Thank you.
On behalf of CLASP and the Americas Award, thank you so much to Oyster Adams Bilingual School students, as well as Stonewall Middle School students, for your beautiful tributes to this year's Americas Award winners. We will now turn this over to Kira Philip Schnurr, who was the 2015 Review Committee Chair, who will now introduce the Americas Award winners for this year and present the awards.
It's a pleasure to be here today and a privilege as the chair of the review committee that had the honor of reviewing all of the books that you've heard about so far, and the two special, exceptional books which we now turn to and recognize. It's my pleasure to share with you a little bit of information about our two award-winning writers and illustrator in one case, who were recognized as the winners of the Americas Award in 2015. So first, I would like to acknowledge Duncan Tonatiuh for his work, Separate is Never Equal, Sylvia Mendez and her family's fight for desegregation, which you've now heard, courtesy of the students, a snippet of, and I hope you will all take time when you return to your libraries, your classrooms, and your homes to pick up and explore further. It's a beautiful book. Duncan is the writer and the illustrator of it. Drawing on Mesoamerican codices, it tells a piece of American history. We could also argue Latino history, but let's not separate them. It is American history that his work acknowledges in telling Sylvia Mendez's story. So first, allow me to introduce Duncan and present to him a small token of appreciation from the Americas Award. Duncan, we have two pieces for you. We have a certificate in appreciation for all of the work you do to help tell the stories that deserve to be told and that are so often omitted from our histories and our community classrooms overall. And we appeal to emphasize how you weave tapestries together in telling the narratives that you do and in doing so so beautifully. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Well, I'm very happy to be here. Thank you so much for this award. I'm so happy with all the positive energy that the book has received. Thank you to the Oyster Adams actors for that reading, that play of the book. The book, some of you may be familiar with it, but some others may not. So just to tell you a tiny bit about it, the book is nonfiction, and it tells the true story of the Mendez family, especially of Sylvia Mendez, who was a young girl who was not allowed to go to an all-white school in California. This is during the 1940s, and at the time, many places in the Southwest had separate schools for Mexican-American and Latino children. And this is something that not a lot of people know. It's something that I did not know until a few years ago. And when I heard this story, I thought it was very important to tell it. I think it's an important piece of American history that not a lot of people know about. Sylvia's family fought hard. They worked with a lawyer and organized the community, and they were able to change this and make it so that children all across California could go to school together. And this happened 7 years before the landmark case of Brown versus Board of Education. I had the fortune when I first learned about the case to meet Silvia Mendez, and I was able to hear her speak and ask her questions, interview her for the book. So I want to, I want to take this opportunity also to thank her for all that her family did to improve to create positive change in this country, and also because she has always been so so generous and so kind with her time and so open to me making this book. The second reason why I made this book for two reasons. The first one is that I think it's a very important piece of American history that very few people know about. The second part is that I think a lot of the issues that Sylvia was confronting 70 years ago are still faced by children and by students and by families nowadays. At the end of the book, I have an author's note, and I mentioned a study by UCLA that came a few years ago that says that in fact segregation in public schools in the United States has increased over the last decade, and that African American and Latino children are more likely to be in a school where the majority of the students are poor and where only a very small percentage of their classmates are white. So even though legal segregation is no longer allowed in the way that it was 70 years ago, a lot of the problems that Sylvia faced are still being faced by families and by children nowadays. In the book, if you may notice from the cover, if you see the book later on, you'll see that the ears in the characters look a little bit like a number three, that the different characters are always in profile. You usually see their entire body. And that's kind of an unusual way to draw, and sometimes I think it usually strikes people and some people find it a little odd. But that all comes from looking at pre-Columbian art, at the art of the Mixtec people, and of other civilizations that made books. They made their own books hundreds of years ago, 500 years ago. And I look at the artwork and how they did their artwork. And I wanted to continue that tradition of art in some kind of way. But hopefully, I'm doing it in a way that's that children nowadays, young readers nowadays can relate to. And I hope you guys have an opportunity to read this book, to share it with your families. And I just want to take a few moments also to thank the Americas Award for this great award, this great honor. They do, awards like this are very helpful. There's a very large number of books that get published each year, children's books, about 10,000, but only a small percentage of them are about minorities, and even a smaller percent, and out of that small percentage, only a small percentage are about Latinos. So awards like this give a book like this visibility and help people hopefully realize that these books are important because they help young readers see themselves reflected in these stories, and for other children that in this case are not Latino, it helps them see the experience of other people and hopefully create empathy. And the CLASP and the Americas Award also do a wonderful job of creating curriculum and different study guides and finding ways of using the book in the classroom very much like the playwright readers did today. So I'm just very honored to receive this. I'm very thankful for my publisher, my editor, who first introduced me to this story, in fact, and for all the support and the love the book has received. Thank you.
So we thank Duncan. Thank you for your work. It's an honor to recognize you, and it's always a pleasure and a privilege to read his books and to enjoy the illustrations. In a likewise fashion, the review committee was captivated by the work of Margarita Engle for her work with Silver People, Voices from the Panama Canal. Again, you've been fortunate today to hear such a wonderful rendition from the students, who did an exceptional job in showing you the depth of voices, the diversity of voices, and the perspective that she manages to imbue in young adult novels written in verse. And as you can also see, hopefully, from today's presentations with the students, they are inspiring. They give voice to voices that are often omitted or displaced or silenced in our common narratives. And it is always a joy and a memorable experience to read her novels. Today, we honor her, as we do with Duncan, for the 2015 Américas Awards. So please join me in welcoming Margarita.
Thank you so much. Gracias.
This is so exciting. Students and Linda and your colleagues who are here, you just have no idea how satisfied I feel to see students reading like that with so much passion and skill, and it was just beautiful, it was gorgeous. And the children who did the other theater too, thank you. The first time I came to the Library of Congress to receive an Américas Award for a different book quite a few years ago, I stood up and said this was the highlight of my life. It couldn't get any better than this. But today I've got to say that it got better through this complete surprise of the wonderful participation of the students. It's just amazing. Thank you. I'm so grateful to the awards committee, to all the individuals who were involved, and to CLASP, the Library of Congress, to my publisher, Harcourt, the editor who started with this book, Rekha Simonson, and when she changed jobs, the one who took it over, Jeanette Larson, and to Teaching for Change and Bus Boys and Poets for last night's teacher's workshop that was related to this award also. It's amazing how so many people have come together to celebrate Hispanic Heritage Month here in this way. Now, I am Cuban American, and most of my books have been about Cuba, primarily historical verse novels, although I've written some books for younger children about different subjects. But I'm actually, before I start talking about Silver People, I'm actually gonna hold up the cover of my new memoir to show you who I am. I am the face on a bird that flies back and forth between two countries. My father is American, my mother is Cuban. They met when he had seen pictures of her town in National Geographic magazine way back in the middle of the last century. And it was before the Cuban Revolution, travel was unrestricted. He went to her hometown. They met on his first day there, which happened to be Valentine's Day. It was love at first sight. Can you see a problem? He only spoke English and she only spoke Spanish, but they were artists, so they passed pictures back and forth to get to know each other. And they're still married 68 years later. So if you wonder whether love at first sight, not speaking the same language, can work, it takes time, but you can learn another language, right? So that's who I am. I was a child who was able to travel freely back and forth, spending the summers in Cuba and getting to know my mother's extended family. But we lived during the school year in my father's hometown of Los Angeles, California. And so I feel very strongly that I belong to two cultures. And even though my trips to Cuba were interrupted for 31 years. I started going back in 1991. I still feel completely bicultural. And I know that so many of the students here today probably have strong feelings for more than one place, for more than one country. Perhaps you visit relatives in another country. But for me, writing about Panama was very different. And yet I felt inspired, I felt called to write this book, and I wanted it to come out in 2014, the centennial of the opening of the Panama Canal. During those 31 years when I couldn't travel to Cuba due to travel restrictions, I traveled a lot in other parts of Latin America. And in my first career, I was a botanist and agricultural specialist. So I traveled in the rainforest and in rural areas, studying plants and getting to know the people. And I was curious in Central America at why there were English-speaking Jamaican communities in Central America. And it took me a long time to realize the connection between the history. Once I learned how they got there, I was fascinated and I did a lot of research. Caribbean islanders from all the islands, but especially from the English-speaking islands, and especially Jamaica and Barbados, were recruited by the hundreds of thousands, first by France and later by the United States, in an effort to dig the Panama Canal, which would connect all the countries of the western side of the Pacific with the countries of the eastern side of the United States. It was an engineering project unheard of, but it took a lot of people to accomplish it. And when the canal opened in 1914 and was then celebrated at the Panama Pacific Exposition in San Francisco in 2015, there was no honoring of the laborers who had dug the canal, the Caribbean islanders. Everybody talked about the engineering, but they forgot about the people who did the work. And the book is titled Silver People because the laborers from the Caribbean islands and Southern Europeans who also worked on the canal were paid in silver, while Americans and Northern Europeans were paid in gold. And it was not only an unfair payroll system, it was also complete segregation to the point where you could call it apartheid. Living conditions in every single aspect. Now, the book came out with this absolutely gorgeous cover. I love the cover. But the illustrator had focused on the romance between two of the main characters, and the Jamaican character, Henry, had been left off. So in the paperback, this paperback, which will come out this spring, Henry will be included along with Mateo and Anita. So I'm very happy with that cover too. I love all the covers. The middle one is an Australian edition that was published simultaneously by the University of Queensland Press. And they had their own vision of the cover showing the couple from the back rather than being able to see their faces. A lot of words had to change for the Australian edition because Australian English is so different. It was hard for me to imagine hundreds of thousands of men with shovels coming from the islands, living in the jungle, and doing this incredibly hard work. Ordinarily, I would read some of the poems out of the book, but I'm not going to do that because I can't do it as well as you already did. You've satisfied that part of this talk so well already. So I'm going to talk a little bit more about how I did the research and what inspired me.
The canal connects two oceans,
and in doing so, cuts the country of Panama in half. Panama wasn't a country until the United States decided to build a canal. It was the northern province of Colombia. But Colombia would not give permission for the United States to dig a canal because the French had already tried throughout the late 1800s and had failed miserably. Their chief engineer failed so miserably, it brought down the entire French economy, stock market crashed. Gauguin, who had been working in Panama, gave up and went to Tahiti to paint. Eiffel, who had been the engineer, gave up and went back to Paris and built a tower instead. But the story is so huge. So many people were involved. Imagine what it meant back then with relatively primitive equipment to connect two oceans. And the oceans are not at the same level. So they have to be, those ships have to be lifted and lowered in locks as they move through. And as if that wasn't hard enough, the canal had to dig through the continental divide. It wasn't put in on flat ground, it was put in the mountains. So the mountains had to be dynamited. First the trees were cut, of course. The mountains were dynamited away, and then the digging began. It took a lot of people. The large crowd you see in the rear of this photo is the laborers from the Caribbean islands and Southern Europe and many other parts of the world. There were over 100 nations involved. And in the foreground, you see a few of the Americans who were in charge. Here you see them at separate payroll cars waiting to get their money on payday, either silver or gold. Depending, you know, there's just no way around this, depending on the color of their skin. Silver people were darker skinned. The lighter skinned silver people, the Southern Europeans, like the Spaniards, were paid twice as much as the darker skinned silver people, the black Caribbean islanders from Jamaica, Barbados, and dozens of other islands. So it was a very clear-cut case of racial discrimination. This is the serpent cut. You can see how hard it must have been to dig with shovels on a slope this steep. Now, I live in California, where we would be so happy to have 6 inches of rain this year. 16 inches of rain, we'd just be in heaven. Panama gets 16 feet of rain per year. So in this extremely rainy climate, digging on steep slopes, there were landslides. It was dangerous work. And the islanders out there with shovels were in the most dangerous positions. As they dug, the soil and rock had to be moved up out of the cut and disposed of, you know, to leave a place for the water to later be flooded. So train tracks were set up and they had to be constantly moved deeper and deeper into the cut to bring the dirt and rock up out of the cut. And the Spaniards were the ones who were hired to move the train tracks. So here you see what it means back then without a lot of heavy equipment, how train tracks were moved. It was heavy, hard work. Not as dangerous as digging, but still extremely heavy labor. The one thing that inspired this book the most is in looking at these old photos, I felt compassion for the way that people were treated. And it went in degrees, depending on their skin color, how badly they were treated. The Spaniards had railroad tracks to sit on when they ate lunch. The Black Islanders had no place to sit. They had to eat lunch standing up. It was uncomfortable, it was undignified, it was humiliating. And the Americans and Northern Europeans ate in comfortable dining halls with tablecloths and fans. This was a colonial era. We don't think of the United States as a colonial power, but in this context, it certainly was. I was also fascinated by the images of the indigenous people whose homes were flooded when the canal was built. The rainforest was cut down in an enormous area, not just the canal, but an enormous artificial lake that was required by damming a river in order to fill the locks to raise the water level to move the ships. So it was just a devastating environmental disaster for people living out in the rainforest. This photo is my inspiration for Anita. Even though I didn't put her on a horse in the story, she goes out on a boat more, but just this girl with her fruit to sell and the umbrella, to me she just looked so dedicated working so hard in the rain. As this took a very long time, and as the project was nearly completed, the American tourists began to arrive, and President Theodore Roosevelt was the first president to ever leave the United States while in office. And he did it as a photo opportunity. He posed, I didn't include his picture because I get annoyed by people who want to be remembered in a certain way. So there's a very famous picture of him posing on a steam shovel pretending to drive the steam shovel. But people came to see him, and they came to see the engineering marvel of the canal, but they were up above where the workers were digging below. And they saw him wearing a white hat, and he wore it in Panama, so they called it a Panama hat, and the newspapers repeated that until everybody thinks Panama hats are made in Panama when they were actually from Ecuador. The Panamanian hat is black and white. It's very different. All of these images come from this excellent Dover edition of historic photographs of the Panama Canal, which is very inexpensive and a wonderful resource to have in a classroom along with the book. But this shows how a river was dammed in order to create the lake to fill the locks. I didn't understand what a lock was until I went through the canal in a boat while doing the research. This is the lake, and the students mentioned how a mountaintop in the flooded lake became an island, and it's one of the most well-researched remnants of tropical rainforest in the world. We did have a chance to visit that and see a lot of wildlife in the land of many butterflies while researching this. And the howler monkey is up in the upper left there, yelling. This is an arboreal anteater, a tamandua, and then a capuchin monkey. This is a sky pond at the center of an air plant. Those students who've read the book will know what I'm talking about, where rainwater is trapped at the center of the flower and creates, not the flower, but the whorl of leaves, and creates a little pond where insects and frogs live. This is to show the change in size of the ships from the time when the canal opened to now. And now, when you see a container ship go through the canal, or even a large cruise ship. I went through on a smaller boat. But when you see these really huge container ships coming from China, bringing stuff to you that you've ordered online for next day delivery, when it actually took a lot longer than a day to get here, there are inches on the side. And the pilot is going, like, don't scrape the boat on the edge of the lock. So they're widening the lanes of the Panama Canal in order to fit bigger and bigger container ships. Well, the most difficult aspect for me of the writing process was narrowing more than 100 nationalities down to a few voices, choosing which voices to include and leaving out so many important ones. But I did it because I wanted to create several love stories. There's the love story between Mateo and Anita. There's the love story where Henry falls in love with an indigenous girl and becomes part of the new Panamanian culture of several blended origins. And then there's my love story with the tropical rainforest, because I wrote this as a love letter also. Today, all over the world, various forms of segregation are still rampant. Laborers are still recruited from distant places and brought into an unfamiliar country to work under systems of virtual apartheid, and they're expected to not become part of the country. But they do. Cultures do blend. Languages do merge. People do fall in love at first sight and get married even though they didn't speak the same language, and you end up with a mixed culture. So I hope that young readers like you, that when you did such a beautiful job, I feel like I'm certain that you understood the book because you did such a beautiful job reading. I hope that it helps inspire you to understand the importance of people treating each other fairly and of protecting not only rainforests but all the plants and animals who speak to you from the pages of books. And I hope that you will eventually get to travel and see different places, because traveling, as I was able to do as a child, has no substitute. It's the only way to really experience complete empathy and compassion for people who live in different ways than you do, is to get to understand each other and become friends. And the same is true for friendships between countries, that we have to interact with each other. So for me to talk to you about Panama right now, it's really special, but I also just want to mention that the timing, whenever you hope for something, I hoped for more than 50 years for reestablishment of diplomatic relations with Cuba and free travel, and things that you hope for are possible. They take a long time, but I just want to say to the students that whatever you hope for, never give up. It might take 50 years, but it's possible. Thank you.
So as we wrap up the ceremony, I just would like to say that as our writers, and in Duncan's case, of course, the dual role of illustrator, have emphasized to us, these are issues and stories that continue to have importance. They're historical narratives, but they continue to impact our lives. They remind us of what is important, how we can be social justice activists as readers, as students, as teachers, librarians, and individuals in our community. And they give us a sense of optimism for how we can continue to make positive changes in the world around us. So briefly, once more, please join me in thanking both of our writers. It's also a special moment for me, being the person to close out the ceremonies, to take this chance to thank two people who are otherwise invisible, silent agents of change in this whole process. So please join me in thanking Denise and Jamie Lee for all the work that they do as well. And I thank you all for coming, and I hope that you will stay and join us. We have refreshments in the back, and have a wonderful day.
This has been a presentation of the Library of Congress. Visit us at loc.gov.